Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Deadly Dinner Party and Other Medical Detective Stories by Jonathan A. Edlow, narrated by Joel Richards. Preface. When I was a teenager, my mother gave me a paperback book called The Medical Detectives by Berton Roueche. These stories had all been previously published in an occasional series in The New Yorker called The Annals of Medicine. I had never heard of The New Yorker back then, and I had no particular desire to pursue a career in medicine. But I do remember devouring these stories one after another, and being sad when each one was over, and sadder still when I had finished the book. The volume was a collection of real-life medical mysteries, clusters of patients with odd symptoms, bizarre outbreaks of unusual diseases, and full-scale epidemics. The common thread was diagnosis, but not just any diagnosis. In each case, the solution proved tough to find. It was never a simple X-ray or routine blood test that made the final diagnosis, but doctors playing detective. Some physician or medical epidemiologist had to delve beneath the surface to find all the pieces and solve the puzzle. The first of these stories that I ever read was called 11 Blue Men. As it turns out, I was not the only person who found this story fascinating. The television series House used it for its pilot episode. Another book that I read as a teenager was The Complete Stories of Sherlock Holmes. These yarns had the same effect on me, always making me wonder which facts would turn out to be clues and which were red herrings. I liked these stories and short novels so much that I reread the entire Sherlock Holmes canon as a college student. Part of the appeal in both sets of stories was their length, not too short and not too long. As an adult, my attention span is not much longer than it was when I was a teenager, and I liked being able to read these tales in a single sitting. The second element they had in common was the simple pull of any detective story. Figuring out who done it, and following, at least in retrospect, how the hero, whether an epidemiologist or Sherlock Holmes himself, solved the puzzle. Last, each of these miniature mysteries had all the elements of any good story, plot, character, and setting. The writing placed the reader in the midst of the investigation, just like Dr. Watson, the sidekick to Holmes. Part of every doctor's and epidemiologist's job is to solve mysteries. Many are not so challenging. A patient consults a doctor because of fever and bloody diarrhea after eating undercooked hamburger. The doctor sends a stool culture and E. coli grows out. Case closed. Or a patient shovels heavy wet snow, develops chest pains, and comes to an emergency department. An electrocardiogram shows a heart attack. Another patient seeks medical advice in June for a low-grade fever and a large, unusual red rash over the abdomen at the site of a tick bite. It doesn't take a Sherlock Holmes to diagnose Lyme disease. But sometimes, patients present problems that can be far more challenging. The clues lead to dead ends. The X-rays, blood tests, and CT scans are normal. Even smart doctors are unable to make a diagnosis. Or sometimes, they make a presumptive diagnosis, but the treatment fails. In these cases, the doctor becomes detective, and the diagnosis can be as elusive as any criminal. Clues may not be so easy to find, sometimes because they are hiding out in the open, just as in Edgar Allan Poe's The Purloined Letter. Sometimes doctors may call in the local public health epidemiologists to help with the problem. In other situations, if the scope of the outbreak overwhelms local resources, the Epidemiology Intelligence Service of the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention will be called in. Dr. Alexander Langmuir created this service in about 1950, when he began training a cadre of young physicians to become the country's medical sleuths. The young men and women who work for this program today are available on a moment's notice, suitcases pre-packed, to respond to any outbreak of disease or epidemic in the United States. They're famous for what Langmuir called shoe leather epidemiology. They solve cases the old-fashioned way, like the detectives in any good mystery story, by knocking on doors, interrogating witnesses, coming up with hypotheses, and then testing them. With this in mind, as an adult, I began collecting my own medical mysteries, and was fortunate enough to have Boston Magazine and Ladies Home Journal publish some of them. I thank all the many individuals who made time to share parts of these stories with me. People necessarily have an anthropocentric view of the world, but even though we may be at the top of the food chain, that doesn't mean we have dominion over the world or our environment. As Friedrich Nietzsche put it, "The human is by no means the crown of creation. Every living kind stands beside it on the same level of perfection. In fact, we share our planet with an uncountable number of other species, each one scratching out its own ecological niche. When humans fall ill to some virus or bacterium, it is simply the interplay between competitors in the same environment, each procreating and fulfilling its own biological destiny. Several of the stories here may be classified as human meets pathogen. In the deadly dinner party, a notorious bug makes its mark and turns a suburban meal into a disaster that almost claims its host. This case shows how a microorganism can strike, not through a direct assault on human beings, but by a toxin that it elaborates. A tale like this provides an extraordinary lesson about the history of the relationship between humans and our cohabitants on the planet. Everywhere That Mary Went exemplifies our struggle with another bacterium that has evolved such that Homo sapiens provides its only natural reservoir, hitchhiking, as it were, with our species. This is a story not only of an interesting outbreak of disease in the Catskills, but one about a malady that has had a major impact on human activities over centuries. The Baby and the Bathwater, another case of infection, is a detective story par excellence. It shows how epidemiologists think and how shoe leather epidemiology, not to mention hunches and an occasional bit of luck, plays into the solution of a mystery. Rubbed the Wrong Way is a prime example of how the most mundane of human activities, personal hygiene, can lead to troublesome problems. Our microcosm becomes a bacteria's microcosm, where several square feet of our body's surface is their entire universe. Rounding out the first part of the book, The Forbidden Fruit illustrates not only the connection between bacteria and humans, but the considerably more complex interplay of other animals, microorganisms, and people, sometimes with catastrophic results. This last case introduces the importance of the world around us. Our relationship to non-living parts of the environment is another category of exposure to illness. As fans of this genre will recognize, the title of the next story, Two Ticks from Jersey, pays homage to Berton Roueche, whose A Pig from Jersey, about trichinosis contracted from eating undercooked pork, was included in his original collection. In the tick story, we again see the ramifications of our life on a planet that we share with other creatures. Ticks have become increasingly important as vectors for a variety of diseases, mostly infectious. In this story, the lives of two little girls were in peril. A large part of our lives is work, and work can sometimes be dangerous. In An Airtight Case, a young executive was diagnosed with lung cancer. The odd thing was that his tumors seemed to wax and wane, and he was otherwise the picture of health. His physician was the detective who solved a mystery that baffled other doctors. Monday Morning Fever shows how a manufacturing process was central to the solution of a mini-epidemic in a small New England mill. This story is a classic example of how doctors see trees, while epidemiologists see forests. Sometimes, examining the commonalities in a group of cases helps to establish the diagnosis in an individual patient. But we do not even need to leave the house for the environment to invade our space. It's everywhere. In The Case of the Wide-Eyed Boy, we see how even a 10-year-old can be the victim and how an emergency physician's sixth sense alerted him to the presence of an unusual problem that cracked the case. We must also remember that there are really two environments, the internal and the external. The famous French physiologist Claude Bernard first introduced the term internal milieu to the scientific lexicon in 1865, when he wrote that the internal environment, in this case, the inside of a cell, must be maintained within certain constant parameters for the cell to survive. But whether we mean an individual cell or an individual organism, this principle remains true. The interplay between internal and external environments is yet another category for diseases in humans. In A Study in Scarlet, this time a nod to Sir Arthur Conan Doyle's story of the same title, an alert infectious disease specialist at a medical conference suspects an unusual cause behind an outbreak of disease in a quaint New Hampshire hotel. Once again, an epidemiologist's hunch plays a role in solving a colorful case. In another story, the case of the overly hot honeymoon, the patient's brother, then a medical student, helped to unravel the mystery of why his sister could eat her football-playing husband under the table without gaining weight. This is a classic case of the internal milieu gone haywire. In this day and age of food additives, irradiated fruits, genetic manipulation of crops, and fast food, eating healthily has become a near obsession for some. In Feeling His Oats, a former advertising executive from Connecticut starts a health food diet and almost eats himself to death by following the instructions in a best-selling diet book. The case of the unhealthy health food presents a similar theme. A suburban housewife, suspected of having cancer, undergoes numerous invasive tests and surgical procedures, but her diagnosis proves elusive. A curious medical student with time on his hands finds that the problem is not a cancer, but, paradoxically, comes from a product that the patient is taking to feel better. In Little Louisa's Blinding Headache, a young girl nearly loses her vision from a health potion her grandmother had given to her with the best of intentions. The concoction contains substances that may be helpful at one dose, but toxic at another. Finally, in Too Much of a Good Thing, children in the Boston area get sick from something that belongs to a rite of childhood. When adults in the area also become ill, doctors begin to put the pieces of the puzzle together at a local educational conference. The three categories of exposure to diseases are by no means simple and binary. They frequently overlap. Our world is a complex place. The interactions between host and environment, both external and internal, and pathogen, can be equally complex. The lessons learned from these stories can help us negotiate this sometimes fragile relationship. My hope is that the listener will be able to profit from these stories through both their educational as well as their entertainment value. Part 1. Human Meets Pathogen. 1. The Deadly Dinner Party. The get-together began as an afterthought, recalls Pam Stoges, a 43-year-old city legislator from Kingston, New York, a town nestled between Catskill State Park and the Hudson River. My husband, my daughter, and I were planning to go out for Mexican food. I asked our friend, Steve Gelson, to join us, but he invited us to his house to eat. Steve is a marvelous chef and had hosted a party the night before and had plenty of food left over. He said, "Nothing formal, don't get dressed up, just come over." My husband and daughter were set on Mexican, but I went to Steve's. It was a totally last-minute affair. Five other guests, the names of all persons in this story have been changed, attended the dinner party on Sunday, February 19, 1989. Miles Walsh, Steve's business partner in an ad agency, Arthur Landry, vice principal of the local high school, his wife, Barbara Landry, co-owner of their family travel agency, Janie, their 13-year-old daughter, and her friend Sarah, also 13. The meal included a homemade cheese ball, salad, a pasta casserole with sausage, sweet and sour meatballs, garlic bread, and wine, followed by coffee and homemade fudge cake. It turned out to be a memorable menu in more ways than one. I doctored up the leftover pasta dish and made a garlic bread out of pita slices, Gelson recalls. It was a relaxing evening. We talked a lot of politics. Pam and I are active local Republicans, and Art, a Democrat, had just been told he would soon be appointed to a city commission. It was very informal, says Pam. Steve arranged the food on the kitchen counter and the adults ate in there. The girls took their plates into the living room and watched videos. We had a grand time, but it was a school night, so by 10 p.m. we finished our coffee and the party was over. By Tuesday morning, Pam knew something was wrong. I was working in the kitchen. I looked up at something, and my eyes wouldn't work right. I thought maybe I'd put my contact lenses in backwards, so I went into the bathroom, cleaned and checked them, and put them back on. But things still weren't right. It was like I was looking at my nose cross-eyed. I figured I had the flu. I phoned Steve's office, because as trustees of the Ulster County YWCA, we had a noon meeting. His secretary told me he was homesick, and when I called him, his speech was slurred, and he complained of nausea. He said he wouldn't be coming to the meeting. I said that I'd speak with him at dinner time and to let me know what he wanted, and that I'd make it and bring it over to him. By that evening, Tuesday, Pam continues, my eyes were worse, and my speech had also become slurred. I was having trouble talking, and remember having to form the words to get them out. I called Steve again that evening, and he could hardly speak. Then the idea occurred to me that Steve and I had the same bug. Still, Pam isn't the panicky type, and still wasn't particularly concerned about her own health. She assumed that she probably just had a virus that would eventually run its course. Wednesday morning, I started to drive to do some errands, but as I pulled out of the driveway, the street didn't look wide enough for the car, so my husband drove me. When I went to sign a check, I couldn't find the right line. I was trying to hold some toothpicks, but kept dropping them. It was odd. I was having perceptual problems, and it gave me a whole new perspective on how handicapped people must have to deal with the world. By Thursday morning, Pam felt so feeble that it was all I could do to walk. My legs were so weak. By now I was getting nervous, and I'm not the nervous type. My husband and I own a funeral home, and the prospect of death doesn't frighten me. I remember telling my husband, I think I've had a stroke, Pam recalls. I felt intoxicated and totally out of touch perceptually. I telephoned Steve's house, and there was no answer. I called his secretary, who told me he'd gone to Kingston Hospital. That's when I thought, my God, maybe someone else has it. I called Art Landry's house. Janie picked up and said her dad couldn't come to the phone. He was sick and couldn't speak. Janie and Barbara were fine, though. By now, I was having difficulty swallowing, chewing, or even moving my tongue. I called Dr. Malcheri, Steve's doctor, and told him about Art and me. He said we should both come to the emergency department at Kingston City Hospital, where Steve was being evaluated, for tests. Dr. Malcheri had already paid Steve two house calls. Malcheri was not only Gelson's doctor, but also a friend. In fact, he had been a guest at the first dinner party on Saturday night. He saw Steve at home on Wednesday and was somewhat concerned. But when he saw him again on Thursday at about 2 p.m., he sent Gelson straight to the hospital. I remember he took my portable phone, said Steve, and called a neurologist, Dr. Pickard, on the telephone. He said, I've got a patient I'd like you to see today. I'm concerned he could have Guillain-Barré syndrome. By 4 o'clock that afternoon, the consulting neurologist, Dr. Leonard Pickard, was evaluating Steve Gelson in the emergency department. Pickard at this point was still unaware that Art and Pam were also ill. When he finished examining Steve, He was both puzzled and worried. Two major possibilities occurred to him: myasthenia gravis and Guillain-Barré syndrome, both potentially fatal neurological disorders. But Steve's symptoms didn't quite fit with either diagnosis, Pickard recalls. And there was one other possibility that Dr. Malcheri and I discussed. Pam Stogis remembers. Shortly after 4 p.m., Art and I joined Steve at the emergency room, and we must have been quite a sight. Steve's head hung limp to one side. His eyelids drooped shut, so that when he spoke, he had to pry them open with his fingers. Art, a community leader, looked like a drunken bum. He hadn't shaved for a couple of days, and he wore a baseball cap cocked to one side. After I examined Mr. Gelson, recalls Dr. Pickard, his father told me about Pam Stogis and Art Landry. The clustering of cases was what clinched it. Even though I'd never seen a case, I knew they had botulism. Botulism, which derives from botulus, the Latin word for sausage, is a rare but often fatal form of food poisoning caused by the bacterium Clostridium botulinum. According to Dr. A. Barnett Christie's eminently readable textbook on epidemiology and infectious diseases, the history of the word botulism and the discovery of the causative organism dates back more than 200 years. Christie wrote, "The term was first used in the last years of the 18th century following an outbreak of the disease in Wildbad in southern Germany in 1793. A large sausage had been shared by 13 people, all of whom became ill and 6 of whom died." Much of what is currently known about the clinical effects of botulism was catalogued by a young district medical officer in the Duchy of Württemberg named Dr. Justinus Körner. At the beginning of the 19th century, in the area surrounding Stuttgart, the medical administration of the dukedom noticed an increase in cases of fatal food poisoning, which they ascribed to the general decline in hygienic measures for food production that resulted from the poverty caused by the devastating Napoleonic Wars. In July 1802, the government in Stuttgart issued a public notice and warning about the harmful consumption of smoked blood sausages. Körner, who also developed a lasting reputation as a romantic poet, began publishing his findings in 1817. By 1820, he had written a monograph that included data from 76 patients he had seen with sausage poisoning, as it was referred to at the time. Körner performed animal experiments and did many autopsies on patients who had died from botulism. By the mid-1820s, he had established most of what we currently know to be true. He wrote, "The tear fluid disappears, the gullet becomes a dead and motionless tube, no saliva is secreted, no drop of wetness is felt in the mouth, no tear is secreted anymore." Using various extracts that he made from the sausages, Körner experimented on cats, rabbits, birds, snails, insects, and frogs. He was able to produce all the typical symptoms: dilated pupil, droopy eyelids, vomiting, problems with swallowing, and respiratory failure in these animals. But Körner went even further. Like many physicians of his time, he experimented on himself. After taking very diluted extracts from a sausage, he wrote, "Some drops of the acid brought onto the tongue produced great drying out of the palate and the pharynx." When the university professor who had been his instructor discovered that Körner was poisoning himself in the name of research, he wisely forbade future self-experimentation. Although Körner tried in vain to produce the toxin, he did uncover the three major principles about sausage poisoning. He learned that the toxin is created in the bad sausage when it is stored in an oxygen-free state, that the toxin acted on both the motor and autonomic portions of the nervous system, and that the toxin was extremely potent and could lead to symptoms in very small doses. Most remarkably, Kerner speculated in his 1820 report that certain diseases that are caused by a hyperstimulated or hyperexcited nervous system might in fact be treated by the toxin. It was not until 1870 that the word botulism was formally coined by another German physician. It took nearly 30 more years for the causative organism to be defined, in part because the necessary tools of bacteriology were still in their infancy during the late 19th century. Finding the organism that was actually causing botulism is a story in itself. It starts in the tiny village of Eluzel, Belgium. 34 individuals attended a funeral on a cold day in December 1895. The food served for the occasion included both smoked and pickled ham. The latter had been pickled within 24 hours of slaughter and kept in brine for 11 days before it was consumed. It didn't look right, and it didn't smell right, but that did not seem to have dampened the enthusiasm with which it was eaten by the guests and members of the village band, who apparently were playing both for the funeral as well as a local festival. The first victims fell ill in less than 24 hours, and in all, 23 people became sick. 3 died, and 10 nearly died. Some who had eaten smaller amounts had a mild illness, and a few, who had eaten only fat or very small pieces of the meat, had no symptoms at all. Dr. Emil Pierre von Ermengen, who had studied under the great German pathologist Robert Koch, investigated. He found a large anaerobic, grows in the absence of oxygen, bacillus, long bacterium, in the ham that had been served at the funeral, and in the tissue of some of the victims as well. From these samples, he grew the bacteria in the laboratory. Finally, when he fed cats food laced with the organism, they developed paralysis. Dr. Ermengen had finally found the cause. He published his findings in a German microbiology journal. This was the first recorded isolation of Clostridium botulinum. 9 years later, in 1904, an outbreak of botulism from canned white beans surprised researchers, for it had been thought that only meat or fish could lead to the disease. Over succeeding decades, researchers worked out additional details that built on the early pioneers' theories. The active bacterium, C. botulinum, has a biological peculiarity in that it grows only in the absence of oxygen. The organism has an inactive stage called a spore. The spores can live indefinitely, even in extreme cold or heat. They remain active even after being boiled for hours. Under anaerobic conditions, the spores germinate into the active bacterium, and then the bacteria produce the toxin, one of the most deadly known. Somewhat unbelievably, in 1964, it was estimated that 14 ounces of botulism toxin could kill the entire population of the world. Kerner was quite fortunate with his forays in self-experimentation, because even so much as a nibble of tainted food can be fatal. In one small outbreak in Loch Maree, Scotland, in 1923, 8 members of a fishing party lunched on duck pate sandwiches. Within a week, all 8 were dead. Botulism toxin, a relatively small molecule, affects the nervous system by rapidly and tightly binding to the area where the nerve transmits its impulse to the muscle. Normally, the transmission of this impulse from the nerve to a muscle is mediated by the release of a chemical neurotransmitter, acetylcholine. The acetylcholine then binds to the muscle, causing it to contract. If insufficient acetylcholine binds to the muscle side of the connection, the muscle will not fire. If the diaphragm, the muscle that controls breathing, is affected, one can no longer breathe and will die unless emergency treatment is begun. There are at least 7 types of C. botulinum, somewhat unimaginatively labeled A through G. But types A, B, and E cause most disease in humans. The bacteria and its spores are everywhere, yet botulism is quite rare. In part, this is because, although the spores are quite hardy, the toxin is quite frail. Even though heating does not destroy the spores, it routinely destroys the toxin, an Achilles heel that the prudent cook must exploit to avoid the dreaded disease. Contaminated food does not always show signs, such as blown cans or putrid smells of being contaminated. Consider the case of a 22-year-old man from Orange County, California. He awoke one morning at 2 a.m., vomiting, with blurred vision and a thick tongue. Within hours, he was completely paralyzed and he had stopped breathing. He was placed on a ventilator for respiratory support. About 40 hours before the onset of his symptoms, he had eaten some stew that his roommate had prepared from fresh ingredients, meat, carrots, and potatoes. The roommate had eaten the same stew while it was still hot, but the other man had tasted it at room temperature 16 hours later. The heat-resistant spores had survived the first cooking. Any toxin that was in the stew would have been deactivated by the heating, which is why the roommate remained well. While the food was cooling on the stovetop, however, the spores, deep in the stew, and therefore in an anaerobic environment, germinated into C. botulinum bacteria. When the temperature became cool enough, the live bacteria began making toxin, which caused the young man to fall dangerously ill. Cooking food to a high enough temperature just before it is eaten will reliably prevent the disease. According to Christie's textbook, it is clear that any food may cause botulism if it is contaminated with the organism and is first given inadequate heat treatment, then stored for some time, and finally eaten without further cooking. This last point is important, for it will be remembered that botulinum toxin is easily destroyed by heat, and if only home canned food were recooked before being eaten, most of the deaths caused by home canned food could be avoided. Botulism usually develops when a person eats improperly processed food. Outbreaks have been attributed to bottled mushrooms, roasted eggplant and oil, baked potatoes, stews, soups, sautéed onions, carrot juice, home canned fruits and vegetables, chili, meat, and fish. In one sad cluster in 1975, an elderly woman canned some mushrooms, ate some of them, and promptly died. After the funeral, her daughter and daughter-in-law ate some more of the canned mushrooms, and they both developed botulism. Type B, C. botulinum, was isolated from the mushrooms, as well as the gastrointestinal tracts of all three women. In 2002, 14 Alaskans dined on the meat from a beached whale. 8 developed botulism, and 2 would have died without ICU-level care. Native Alaskans are particularly at risk because they eat seal and whale meat, and their most common food preparation practice is to ferment the flesh. In this process, the fresh meat is allowed to putrefy for 1 to 2 weeks in either a pit in the ground or a closed or airtight container. This anaerobic environment is ideal for the formation of botulism toxin. One large outbreak was traced to commercially canned soup. On a hot day in mid-June 1971, a 61-year-old banker and his wife from Bedford Village, New York, cooled off with some chilled vichyssoise. They didn't eat the whole bowl because it had an odd taste, but they ate enough. By the next morning, the man had double vision, followed by weakness of his entire body. 24 hours later, he was dead. Only after his wife developed similar symptoms did the doctors suspect botulism. On July 2nd, the Food and Drug Administration, FDA, released a public warning after learning about the death, and the soup company, Bon Vivant of Newark, New Jersey, launched a recall of the 6,444 cans of vichyssoise that came from the same batch. Bon Vivant manufactured 4 million cans of soup per year, so finding and retrieving these particular cans was no small feat. 5 cans of the vichyssoise were found to be contaminated with the botulinum toxin, and cans from the company's other products also showed signs of improper handling. Therefore, the FDA extended the recall to include all Bon Vivant products and shut down the company's plant in Newark just 5 days after the original warning. By the end of the summer, the company had filed for bankruptcy. Alaskan salmon is another source of at least two instances of botulism linked to commercially canned food. One of the most recent occurrences from a commercially prepared product was the Castlebury canned chili outbreak that erupted during the summer of 2007. Two patients from Texas and two others from Indiana became severely ill. The first two cases were a brother and sister from Lubbock, Texas. Both ate some canned chili made by the Castlebury Company based in Atlanta, Georgia. Both required long hospitalizations. The sister was on a ventilator for more than a month. What is noteworthy in these cases is how widely scattered geographically the victims can be. In another unusual outbreak in 1979 in Nairobi, Kenya, botulism resulted from people eating white ants, which are nutritious even if unappetizing to some. The ants were caught in Kakamega, 300 miles from Nairobi. People who ate fresh ants there remained well, but others placed the ants in sealed plastic bags and brought them to Nairobi 3 days later. By then, enough time had elapsed in this oxygen-free environment so that the Clostridia spores that were present germinated and began producing toxin. 5 of the 6 people who ate the transported white ants died from botulism. Foods that are entirely unprocessed and uncooked do not lead to botulism as long as they are eaten fresh, because the spores themselves do not cause the disease. Some kind of storage or processing is required for the toxin to form. 2 other forms of this disease should be mentioned: wound botulism and infant botulism. In wound botulism, spores in a closed contaminated wound can germinate into the bacteria that then form toxin, which is released into the circulation. This same mechanism has been reported in intravenous drug users. Infant botulism, a newcomer to the botulism family, was recognized only in 1976. In this form of the disease, infants between 1 and 38 weeks old ingest foods that contain the spores, which germinate in the intestine, where they then form toxin, which is absorbed into the baby's bloodstream. The baby develops constipation, then altered sucking, swallowing, and crying, and finally becomes floppy. Some cases of sudden infant death syndrome may be due to botulism. Because honey contains C. botulinum spores and has been associated with clinical cases of infant botulism, pediatricians advise that children less than a year old not be fed honey. There is even one other form of botulism. Precisely as Justinus Kerner predicted, botulinum toxin is now used therapeutically in an odd assortment of syndromes of hyperactive muscle tone, various dystonias, and spasm of the eyelids. More recently, and very commonly, the toxin is used for cosmetic reasons. Marketed as Botox, it temporarily paralyzes the facial muscles, which reduces wrinkles. In 2006, a 34-year-old woman received a Botox injection from a friend who was an unlicensed physician. The product was research grade, but not pharmaceutical grade. 2 days after the injection, she developed double vision, problems swallowing, and weakness. By the time she called an ambulance, her breathing was failing. She was placed on a ventilator and treated with antitoxin. However, her case progressed so rapidly to complete paralysis that it was 3 weeks before she could shrug her shoulders or move her eyes, and 5 weeks before she could speak. After a nearly 4-month hospital stay, she was discharged to a rehabilitation facility. In the standard foodborne botulism, symptoms typically begin within 36 hours after ingestion of the toxin and include dry mouth and difficulty talking and swallowing. Patients frequently have double vision from problems with the muscles that move the eyes up and down and from side to side. Blurred vision also occurs in the majority of cases, perhaps from the droopy eyelids, or ptosis, as physicians call it. Fatigue is profound. In half of the instances, nausea and vomiting never occur, so many patients do not suspect a food-related illness. Fever is absent, and the victims remain mentally intact. As recently as 30 years ago, as many as half of all botulism cases proved fatal. Improvements in intensive care, use of ventilators for respiratory failure, and the development of an antitoxin have dramatically lowered that dismal statistic. Of course, the benefit of those improvements is all predicated on making an accurate diagnosis. Today, severely afflicted patients can be placed on sophisticated ventilators for weeks if necessary, until the poison's deadly grip on the diaphragm has relaxed. The antitoxin is horse serum, prepared by immunizing horses with injections of botulism toxin, then extracting the horse's antibody-rich blood serum and giving it to patients. Because the antitoxin is a horse serum product, patients may develop allergic side effects from the foreign protein, sometimes severe ones. Because of these side effects, doctors like to be sure of the diagnosis before administering a therapy so potentially toxic. On the other hand, because the antitoxin must be delivered as rapidly as possible, they often must give the treatment based on a presumptive diagnosis. Pam Stoges and R. Landry's doctors wanted to try to exclude Guillain-Barré syndrome, another cause of paralysis that can also affect a patient's ability to breathe. So they performed spinal taps on these dinner party guests. If they had Guillain-Barré, their protein levels in the spinal fluid should be high. They weren't. Dr. Pickard phoned the Federal Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, CDC, as soon as he thought that the diagnosis of botulism was likely. His next call was to the state health officials. At 5 p.m. on Thursday, Perry Smith of the New York State Department of Health in Albany took Pickard's call. Alarmed, he immediately informed his director, Dale Morse. Morse recalls, "Dr. Smith received the call, and we each got on the phone. Stan Kondracki, an epidemiologist, was about to step on the elevator to leave for the day, and I motioned for him to come back. I had him begin working on mobilizing the antitoxin from New York City, while Perry was still on the line with Dr. Pickard. Meanwhile, I began talking with the Ulster County officials. We did a lot of work in a very short period of time. We also had to notify the state lab to be prepared to receive specimens used to confirm the diagnosis." In the command post, hastily assembled to deal with the emerging epidemic, Kondracki quickly arranged for release of the antitoxin. The CDC headquarters in Atlanta maintains stockpiles at strategic locations across the country and keeps a phone line available to physicians 24 hours per day, 7 days per week. The nearest antitoxin was at the quarantine station at John F. Kennedy Airport in New York City, about 115 miles away. Until this point, Pam Stoges hadn't been particularly frightened about the disease. But when she heard about the cure, she finally understood that her life was in danger. The doctors explained that there are sometimes serious side effects to the antitoxin, including fatal allergic reactions. That's when I realized how grave the situation was. In the meantime, Ulster County Health Inspectors Brian Devine and Kevin Dumond had arrived at the Kingston Hospital. "I got a call at home," remembers Devine, "from my director, who requested that I initiate an investigation of a possible botulism outbreak. We arrived at the hospital at around 6:15 p.m. After interviewing the patients, we questioned the people who attended the dinner party who had not fallen ill to determine who had eaten which foods." They tallied up just who had eaten what, and based on this information, the inspectors singled out two likely culprits, the garlic bread and the cheese ball. Since all seven diners had eaten the casserole, the sausage, ironically given the origin of the word botulism, was an unlikely source of the toxin. Steve Gelson, Pam Stoges, and Art Landry had all eaten the garlic bread, but so had Barbara Landry. The CDC had already notified Pickard that a garlic and oil preparation had been responsible for a 1985 outbreak in Vancouver, Canada. That incident came to light when two teenage sisters and their mother, who had traveled from Vancouver to Montreal, developed visual problems, difficulty swallowing, and weakness. Botulism was diagnosed. They had eaten at a family-style restaurant back in Vancouver. When this was publicized, many more cases were identified. Ultimately, this outbreak became one of the largest ever in North America, affecting 36 people from three countries, including several areas of the United States, and eight Canadian provinces. The source turned out to be garlic packed in oil, which was supposed to be kept refrigerated, but had not been. When a cluster of typical cases occurs, little else but botulism can explain it. However, nature is not always that accommodating to the diagnostician. One of the most interesting aspects of the Vancouver outbreak was the long list of incorrect diagnoses that these patients were given before the botulism was identified in the three women. Seven had been diagnosed with myasthenia gravis, and four each with viral syndromes and psychiatric disturbances. Three each were diagnosed with stroke and Guillain-Barré syndrome, and many others with a myriad of other conditions, including overexertion. Only the twin sisters and their mother, representing less than 10% of the victims, were correctly diagnosed on the first visit to a physician. Most doctors will never see even a single case of botulism in their entire professional careers, which makes Dr. Pickard's rapid diagnosis all the more impressive. Following up on the CDC's lead about the garlic and oil, Devine found an 8-ounce jar of Colavita minced garlic packed in extra virgin olive oil. "We arrived at Gelson's house at about 10 p.m. and took samples of the garlic and oil, the cheese, and the sausage used in the pasta casserole. We sent these to the state lab in Albany for testing." The garlic had been packed in oil, shielding it from oxygen, and it was not acidified with preservatives. Also, it had been stored at room temperature. This combination provided a near-perfect environment for the spores to germinate into bacteria, which could then produce the toxin in the jar. On Sunday, the evening of the get-together, Steve prepared the garlic bread by slicing pita pockets into eighths, brushing on margarine, garlic, and oil, and then passing them briefly under the broiler, too briefly, as it turned out, to neutralize the toxin. Food must be heated to at least 176 degrees Fahrenheit for 15 minutes to destroy the botulism toxin. Before sending the samples to the lab in Albany, Devine carefully wrapped and labeled each one, an important precaution, since laboratory workers have gotten botulism by inhaling the toxin from improperly prepared samples. At the makeshift command post, Stan Kondracki was working on getting the antitoxin to the patients, but time and weather were working against him.
"The CDC officials released the antitoxin quickly, but it was around rush hour, and the bridges around New York City were backed up, so sending it by ground would take too long. We also missed the last commercial flight out, so I called the state police. Although the weather was not favorable, the police dispatched a helicopter to JFK. The pilot, Technical Sergeant John Ludwig, remembers, "I got a call from Captain Lou Grosso at approximately 6 p.m. He told me there was some kind of serious problem in Kingston. I was at Stewart Airport and needed to pick something up from JFK and take it to Kingston. It was pretty windy on the ground." Ludwig flew to JFK, picked up the parcel, lifted off from the tarmac, dipped the helicopter's nose to the west, and pushed forward into the stiff headwind. After a brief but bumpy flight, he touched down on the landing pad at Kingston's Benedictine Hospital. Local police officers and squad cars met him there. With lights and sirens, the police relayed the serum across town to Kingston Hospital, where all three patients had been admitted to the intensive care unit. Steve Gelson's condition was deteriorating. The decision to administer antitoxin is not one that is made lightly. About 20% of patients receiving the treatment develop side effects. Because the attending physicians almost never know for sure which type of botulism the patient has at this early stage, they administer a trivalent product that protects against all three of the common strains, A, B, and E. For severely afflicted patients like Elson, the risk-benefit ratio clearly favors using the medication. But Pam Stogis wasn't so sure.
We were told there was an antitoxin, but that it had some very serious possible side effects, even the possibility of dying from it. I was frightened by this and decided to wait until the next morning to decide. By Friday morning, I couldn't even pick up my toothbrush, and I decided to get the antitoxin. I got headaches and a rash that lasted 2 to 3 weeks. My whole body turned purple and my face swelled up, and then all of it gradually subsided. But I feel very fortunate to have recovered.
On Friday morning, 5 days after the dinner get-together, Brian Devine shipped the samples he had taken from Gelson's kitchen to the state lab in Albany for testing. By the next day, the state lab had preliminary results suggesting that this was indeed botulism. 2 days later, the lab confirmed that the garlic and oil contained type A botulism toxin, the same type that was later isolated from the patients. On March 1, 1989, the New York State Health Department issued a public advisory to inform people that they should discard any jars of the Colavita brand garlic and oil. The following day, the FDA also issued a warning on the product. The manufacturer, the Colavita Pasta and Olive Oil Company of Newark, New Jersey, voluntarily recalled the product. In all, 300 cases of 4, 8, and 32-ounce jars had been produced. Steve Gelson, Art Landry, and Pam Stogis later filed a lawsuit against the manufacturer, the distributor, and their local retailer of the product. Inspector Devine tried to track the particular jar that Gelson used. Gelson had received the jar of garlic oil in a Christmas gift basket, along with other Colavita products. The health inspector's report is ambiguous as to whether Gelson had stored the jar at room temperature or refrigerated it before opening it for the first time. After the first use, like most conscientious cooks, Gelson always kept it refrigerated. But like most people, he didn't realize that refrigeration would not inactivate any preformed toxin. Garlic comes from the soil, which can contain botulism spores. In the oil, an oxygen-free environment, the spores can germinate and lead to toxin formation. Also, the product was not acidified at the factory with citric or phosphoric acid, a process that would have diminished the likelihood of toxin formation. Devine learned that Gelson had used the jar of Colavita garlic and oil 3 times. The first time was a few months earlier, when he added the garlic to a heated chicken dish. The second occasion was when he put it in the pasta casserole he served on Saturday night, the one that Dr. Malcheri had attended the night before the small impromptu get-together. None of the guests from the Saturday night affair got sick because the dish had been served piping hot. The third time was on the fateful Sunday night dinner party. Ultimately, all 3 victims recovered, although it took several months before they were fully recuperated, and to some extent, none of them felt truly normal for years afterward. During the 1950s and 1960s, the mortality rate in cases of botulism was approximately 50%. In the 1990s, that rate fell to 5 to 10%, thanks to development of the antitoxin and modern ICU-level care. But it is still a number that is alarmingly high if you are one of those affected or know someone who is. And the guests know that things might have turned out much worse. Most of the people at Steve Gelson's house that night never ate any of the garlic bread, as Pam explains. We didn't have room for all the food on the counter, so Steve left the garlic bread on the oven behind his seat. The girls didn't see it when they filled their plates before retreating to the living room. Halfway through the meal, Steve remembered the garlic bread and offered it around. Miles declined. Arth, Barbara, and I each took only 1 small chip. Steve ate 5 or 6 pieces during the rest of the evening. Barbara Landry,
was the one person who ate the garlic bread but did not get sick, either because her particular piece contained very little garlic or because she didn't eat as large a piece as the others. The host, Steve Gelson, ate the most garlic bread and therefore ingested the largest amount of the toxin. Doctors at the hospital had to put him on a mechanical ventilator to restore his breathing, inserting a plastic tube into his trachea to deliver oxygen to his lungs. "I can still feel that tube going down my throat," he recalls, years later, "and how for the first 15 to 20 seconds on the ventilator, you feel like you can't breathe. I was sedated but awake, and it was very panicky. I was on the ventilator for about 2 weeks, and in the intensive care unit for about 5 weeks," he added ruefully. "I only used 2 teaspoons of garlic and oil for the bread. I never understood how toxic such a tiny amount of a substance can be." 2. Everywhere that Mary went. Roy Harvey, a postal clerk from Somerton, New York, married Rita Osborne, both in their early 40s, on June 3, 1989. Their names and the town's name are fictional. Harvey, who doubles as an assistant chief of the local fire department, knew that the New York State Association of Fire Chiefs Convention was going to be held June 11th through 14th in the Catskills, and he planned to attend. With a busy work schedule, finding time for their honeymoon was difficult, but the Catskill Mountains are beautiful that time of year. "So we figured we'd make that our honeymoon too," Harvey recalls. "We had a wonderful time, and I left feeling fine." But that feeling of well-being was not to last. "We were at our camp at Alexandra Bay on the St. Lawrence River for July 4th weekend, and I really began to feel sick, like I was coming down with the flu. Fevers, headaches. I swallowed aspirins by the ton, but they didn't help. I felt bad enough so that on Monday, July 3rd, when my temperature hit 104 degrees, I took myself to the local hospital." The doctors there examined him and agreed with the self-diagnosis of the flu. But the next day, Roy felt even worse. "The weather was really hot, but I was so chilly and freezing that I needed blankets, and my headache was blinding. I didn't even want to open my eyes." The drive back to Somerton was terrible. 90 minutes in a standard transmission truck. And one of the first things I did when I got home was to contact my primary care doctor, Dr. Mitchell Brody. Rita telephoned him. Brody recalls, "I had taken care of Roy for about 7 years, and he'd always been in good health. Because it was unusual for him to call me, I saw him in the office that same day. When he arrived, he looked sick, but I couldn't find a source for his infection on examination." When a patient consults a doctor for a fever, the physician takes a history and performs a physical examination to determine what, among the literally hundreds of possibilities, might be causing the fever. In this regard, Brody had an additional advantage. Besides serving as a primary care doctor to his patients, he also has specialized training in infectious diseases. He served as an infectious diseases consultant to local internists and family practitioners. So he would have asked the standard panel of questions. Was there a new rash, a sore throat, cough or sputum production, abdominal pain or diarrhea, burning on urination, and so on? He also would have asked about recent travel to exotic locales, unusual animal or occupational exposure. Next follows the physical examination. Is there a swollen liver or a new heart murmur, a tender prostate or an inflamed joint or red rash? The combination of the history and the physical examination, along with the context of a case, for example, the season, the patient's age and occupation, will usually point the doctor in one of two directions. A focal process, an infection of a particular organ, as in pneumonia or a urinary tract infection, or a generalized process, an infection that does not settle in any one part of the body, as with a virus that simply leaves a patient feeling run down and showing a fever. Because the diagnosis was unclear and the patient looked ill, Brody admitted Harvey to the local hospital near Syracuse for further diagnostic testing and to receive intravenous antibiotics, just in case it turned out to be a serious bacterial infection. The other reason for admission was for some old-fashioned observation, a diagnostically useful luxury that modern health economics has all but done away with.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.